For the record, my name is Jerry Frappier, and I'm the Director General of the Power Reactor Regulations. I would like to start by saying these are not ordinary times, and we all recognize the deep impact that the ongoing COVID pandemic is having on Canadian society and society worldwide. All of us have felt this impact, and on behalf of all of our team, I offer sincere condolences to all those who have lost loved ones to this disease. The pandemic has caused a significant modification of how we provide oversight of nuclear power plants, and in a minute I will explain some more of these points. The status report on power reactors, CMD 20M10, was finalized on June the 10th. The following are updates reflecting changes since that date. For Bruce, Unit 4 is now at 89% and is returning to full power. For Pickering, Unit 1 is at 65% and returning to full power. As I noted, the current pandemic has had an effect on our operations. On March 15th, the activation of the CNSC business continuity plan resulted in Ottawa and site staff working from home. Consequently, direct on-site inspection activities ceased. Emphasis was placed on providing as much capability as possible to allow inspectors to continue providing oversight while not on site or in the office. All the inspectors possess computer tablets with virtual private network capabilities. This allows inspectors to access the CNSC network and continue working. Furthermore, arrangements were made to provide inspectors with VPN access to the licensees' information systems. And with this capability, many site surveillance activities do not require a physical presence. Therefore, surveillance continued largely unimpeded. Some inspections were able to continue remotely by reviewing licensees' documents and records. Of particular note was the ability to continue with the regulatory oversight of Darlington Unit 2 as it returned to service after its refurbishment. On April 14th, we issued an updated work procedure to provide direction for the conduct of oversight activities, both remotely and on site, as well as direction on revising the regulatory oversight plan for this fiscal year. This included a review of our planned inspection and decisions on how they could be modified to accommodate our new circumstances. Inspections were reprioritized and procedures put in place to ensure the safety of inspectors in performing on-site inspections. On May 4th, we issued a revised pre-job briefing procedure based on Government of Canada, Public Health Agency, and licensees' COVID-19 protocol directions. This pre-job briefing is a requirement before any CNSC employee goes to an NPP site. And on May 5th, 2020, limited on-site inspections resumed. CNSC staff continue to work on improving remote oversight capability and expect to make more changes as the COVID-19 situation evolves. A last point I would like to make is on many occasions we have been before this commission to discuss emergency planning and various exercises and drills that are required of the licensees in association with emergencies. While normally we talk about nuclear accidents, I would like to let the commission and the public know that there has always been a requirement for business continuity planning, including preparations for pandemics. So the licensees have been preparing for a pandemic even before the arrival of COVID-19. Speaking of the licensees, industry has also undertaken many changes to their operations because of the pandemic, and I believe they are prepared to make a statement on this if you desire. This concludes the status report on power reactors. We are available to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Frappier. Why don't we turn to the licensees and give them an opportunity to give us an update on their response to the pandemic. I'll start with OPG. Dr. Vaccarelli, floor is yours.
Good morning, President Velshi and members of the Commission. Can you hear me all right?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. For the record, my name is Jack Vaccarelli. I am the Vice President of Nuclear Regulatory Affairs and Stakeholder Relations for Ontario Power Generation. On behalf of the industry, in particular the currently operating nuclear generating stations, thank you for the opportunity to provide our perspective on this unprecedented event. With me today are my colleagues, Stephanie Smith from OPG, Maury Burton from Bruce Power, and Jason Nowens from New Brunswick Power. Together, we will give you a brief overview of industry's response to the COVID-19 pandemic thus far. But before we start, allow me to express that we as Canadians have all been touched in some way by COVID-19, and families across Canada have been forever changed by its effects. On behalf of our respective organizations, I would like to express our sincere thanks and gratitude to all those who have worked the front lines in the ongoing battle to keep Canadians healthy, including doctors, nurses, pharmacists, and other healthcare providers. We also thank and appreciate those who continued working to keep us safe, fed, and warm during the pandemic, from police officers and firefighters to the staff at our local grocery stores and gas stations. We are grateful for all of these vital services which have been provided under difficult and challenging conditions. I would also like to acknowledge that throughout this pandemic, our own workers in the nuclear industry have provided an essential service to Canadians. In these unprecedented times, the need to ensure that our hospitals, homes, and long-term care facilities have a safe, reliable source of electricity has never been more important. Throughout the past 3 months, our employees and contractors have worked tirelessly to keep our nuclear plants in Ontario and New Brunswick operating safely around the clock. We're extremely proud of our collective workforce for their dedication and their unwavering focus on working safely through this pandemic. I will now turn it over to Stephanie Smith.
Thank you, Jack. For the record, my name is Stephanie Smith, and I am the Deputy Site Vice President for Darlington. I would like to briefly elaborate on the industry response to COVID-19 and some of the measures implemented by OPG, Bruce Power, and New Brunswick Power. To begin with, we were well prepared. As part of our pandemic planning, we have had a supply of protected equipment on hand, and we have had business continuity plans in place and ready to go. We immediately put protective measures in place for all our staff and have had no known cases of COVID transmission in the days since the onset of the virus. As the risk of COVID-19 emerged, we activated our pandemic planning teams, as well as our incident command teams and centers, in order to coordinate site response and draw upon experience gained from years of preparing for all manner of emergencies, including a pandemic. We focused on essential operating activities and limited major component replacement and refurbishment work, especially in the early stages of the outbreak. We have since moved to resume outage, project, and refurbishment activities in a safe, measured way in consultation with CNSC staff. To ensure physical distancing and to assist our site communities and provinces in flattening the curve, we strictly limited access to our stations and implemented work from home policies for thousands of our employees. To protect those who have continued to work on site, we enacted a host of proactive measures such as implementing a wide range of physical distancing measures, including restricting control room access to critical staff only, staggering start times and designating specific routes to get into and out of generating stations to reduce crowding, monitoring the margin for critical staff available for early indication in case we started to track towards any shortages, monitoring the margin for critical staff available for early indication in case we started to track towards any shortage, verifying we had stockpiled sufficient protective equipment such as masks to protect our essential staff, installing temperature monitoring stations for staff at entrance points to our facilities, instituting face mask protocols to minimize the risk of transmission, and revamping cafeteria and meeting room layouts to create physical distancing, and temporarily closing administrative buildings and redeploying maintenance staff to stations so they could concentrate on their cleaning and disinfecting efforts where they were most needed. We initially deferred all non-regulatory required training and have in the days since increased the amount of virtual classes and online training programs for employees to access remotely. We also recognize the need the outbreak poses to people's emotional and mental health and we have provided staff with access to family assistance programs and medical professionals throughout the pandemic using telehealth applications. Throughout it all, we've shared our insights and ideas with the rest of the nuclear community. As members of the World Association of Nuclear Operators, we are in constant contact with our industry peers to consider lessons learned by operators in all corners of the world. I'll now pass it over to Mari to share a few highlights of what the industry has done as members of wider communities that surround and support our families.
Thank you, Stephanie. For the record, I'm Maury Burton, the Senior Director of Regulatory Affairs at Bruce Power. We are all fortunate to be part of well-informed, supportive communities who understand what we do to protect the public, our workers, and our shared environment. In this challenging time, we look to support our communities as they respond to the unique challenges presented by COVID-19, including collectively, licensees answered the urgent call from our healthcare providers for PPE, donating more than 1 million masks and thousands of protective suits and plastic shields to the medical community. We have hosted a series of interactive virtual town halls and Facebook Live events with provincial and municipal leaders and medical officers of health. This has helped the community leaders reach thousands of residents with vital information. One event even included retired NASA astronaut Captain Scott Kelly, who gave advice to people about living in isolation. In collaboration with local businesses, licensees have distributed thousands of liters of hand sanitizer free of charge to community groups, people in need, including seniors and Indigenous communities, and worked with a variety of partners in the production of thousands of cloth masks. In New Brunswick, NB Power worked with Indigenous and surrounding community members who made cloth face masks to help augment the stockpile of protective equipment used by Point LaProse staff. We have also donated thousands or hundreds of cots and partitions and other equipment to establish field hospitals in local arenas and community centers as proactive measures. Through corporate donations and employee initiatives, we have given hundreds of thousands of dollars to food banks across the country and distributed thank you packages to local health and long-term care workers. In Ontario, we helped create the Retooling and Economic Recovery Council to work with government and the Chamber of Commerce to collaborate on plans to restore the economy, including retooling production lines to produce low-cost ventilators and medical gowns. Through it all, we have continued to produce and harvest about 70% of the world's supply of cobalt-60, which is an important isotope used to sterilize medical equipment at a time when the world needs it most. I will now hand it over to Jason, who will talk about some of the early lessons learned that we've garnered from this event.
Thank you, Maury. For the record, I'm Jason Allens, and I'm the Director of Regulatory Affairs for Point LaProse. Before I reflect on a few of the early lessons we've drawn from our COVID-19 response, let me first say that our work is far from over, even though COVID-19's grip is beginning to loosen in large parts of Canada. While we remain vigilant, we also have begun to look back and consider what elements of our response have worked well and how can we strengthen our emergency plans even further. So what have we learned so far? Not surprisingly, we've learned that our workforce is incredibly resilient. Not so much as a lesson learned as a confirmation, rather. Like so many other Canadians, our employees have risen to the challenge of a once-in-a-century event and adapted to the new normal it has created. Most importantly, they have kept our units running safely and reliably and ensured that the day-to-day routines of their work were met at a time when nothing outside of work was routine. Secondly, we've experienced, once again, the value of our drills and exercises. For us, emergency preparedness is part of regular business, and we regularly simulate all manner of postulated events and test ourselves to respond to things we may never experience or may only experience once in a lifetime, like a global pandemic. As a result, when COVID-19 came to Canada this spring, we were ready. When our response teams gathered in our various command centers, it was not their first time in those chairs. They had pandemic plans ready, and we put them into action. Our experience working through SARS provided our industry with lessons learned and resulted in the implementation of certain processes that have proved invaluable in our response to COVID-19, such as ensuring appropriate inventory of items such as N95 and surgical masks. Of course, executing a plan to deal with a real event over several months is much different than a simulated drill that begins and ends in a day or two. In that way, the pandemic has taught us a few valuable lessons. We've learned how vital a robust supply chain is to an effective initial response, and that while maintaining our pandemic plan had a robust supply of PPE, we were still competing with others for basic items like thermometers and hand sanitizers, which were not easy to obtain. We need to reflect on what we needed most and how best to have it at our fingertips should a second wave hit. Outside of technology challenges, the outbreak has confirmed the value of communication and our community's desire to stay connected in challenging times. Telecommunications tools, thankfully, allow us to host virtual town halls and community liaison meetings, and the internet allows us to update web pages and social media accounts instantaneously. Nothing will ever replace face-to-face communications, but we have used every other method to remain in touch with our neighbors. As Stephanie mentioned, the nuclear industry has a unique global network through WANO, the World Association of Nuclear Operators, to share best practices and lessons learned. It's important to note that we will continue to draw upon that resource in the months and years to come to ensure we're prepared for whatever new challenges lie ahead. We have all been impacted in some manner by COVID-19, and we are bound together to resolve and find a way through this event. We truly are in this together. Once again, thank you for this opportunity to share our industry perspective on this matter. We'd be happy to answer any questions you may have related to our collective response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing your perspectives. I see we've got someone from Hydro-Quebec who's also joined us. Was there anything you wanted to share?
Donald Olivier pour le verbatim, peut-être rapidement juste mentionner qu'Hydro-Québec dispose d'un plan pour faire face à une pandémie. Donc, c'est ce plan-là qui a été déployé au tout début de l'événement. Donc, évidemment, les mesures qui ont été prises, c'est de favoriser la distanciation, les mesures aussi de prévention qui ont été mises en place. Donc, on a réduit nos effectifs à Gentilly dès mars et puis au strict minimum. Les gens sont de retour depuis le 1er juin, donc on est revenu à 100%, pas juste à Gentilly, mais sur l'ensemble des centrales hydroélectriques aussi d'Hydro-Québec. Donc, on a été soucieux de bien communiquer avec nos employés. Donc, la présidente directrice générale d'Hydro-Québec a communiqué avec les employés sur une base hebdomadaire pour les tenir informés parce qu'on croyait que c'était une bonne façon de diminuer le stress ou les inquiétudes des employés. Donc, évidemment, je vous confirme aujourd'hui qu'il n'y a pas eu de cas positif de recenser, de déclarer aux installations de Gentilly. Donc, c'est tout. Si jamais il y a des questions, ça va nous faire plaisir d'y répondre.
Merci. Thank you all for sharing your perspectives.